Yeah, absolutely.
Should we feel like, okay.
Yeah. So as I'm presenting on the different topics, so the way that Nutrition Ninja is designed, the way that it was written is alphabetically. So A stands for something, B stands for something. And what I was going to do is kind of bounce around a little bit based on what I think is the most important points to get to with you guys tonight. So we're going to do that and then hold the questions till the end. Write down your questions as we're going. So if I'm talking about vitamins or minerals and you're like, oh, I want to ask about that question, write it down. Now, if you're really like, I have to know this question right now, just raise your hand and we can get to it right now. Because the number one thing I want from this lecture is you guys to all walk away with answers. Okay, to answers to some of the things that you have been questioning. Come on in.
Are you recording already?
Yeah, you're fine. It's all good. Yeah, you're all good. What you need?
Nothing.
This is super easy breezy. Yeah, come on in. Each of the tables have a packet. Did you want some snacks? Healthy snacks. Okay. Okay. Cool. All right. Well, thank you guys all for being here and being a part of this presentation. Super duper appreciate you all for being here. Again, this information is there's a lot in here. So even if you walk away tonight with one bite-sized thing, that'll be amazing, okay? So Nutrition Ninja, starting with the first letter of the alphabet, A, okay? And A is gonna be for ask questions. So we just talked about that. Whatever questions you have tonight, jot them down. Asking questions, being your own advocate at every appointment. Doctor, nutritionist, psychiatrist, chiropractor. Remember, they are human just like you, and you are hiring them for your health. When they suggest or recommend does not necessarily mean that it's right for you. Your intuition and experience knows best. Designate a folder specifically to keep track of your health records and write down in a notebook all the questions that you have. That way, when it's time for a doctor's visit, you are well-equipped and knowledgeable about your health. Now, why I picked A to be asked questions, A could have been so many things. But to me, that stood out as the most important thing because we have to be our own advocate. You can go to the doctor and they can say, you have high cholesterol. Here's a drug. And you can go, oh, okay, well, I guess I have to be on a cholesterol-lowering medication my whole life now. And a lot of people do that. Don't do that. We're done doing that. We're going to be our own advocate. We're going to question everything, okay? And I'm not saying that the professionals don't know what they're talking about. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying be your own advocate, okay? Jumping from A, we're going to go straight to F. So out of order here in your packet, we're going to go straight to F. And F is on page... Somebody shout it out if they find it before me. Thank you. Page 5. There we go. The bottom of page 5. Bottom of page 5. So F is for food types and fuel. Do you guys all see that? Okay. So my objective tonight is not to talk about diets of what you should eat, what you shouldn't eat, what you can eat, what you can eat, because that does not exist. That does not exist. Food types and fuel are carbs, fats, and proteins. Food is fuel. Food is energy, and we really are what we eat. The muscles are biological machines which convert chemical energy into force and mechanical work. The energy for contraction comes from the chemical reaction between the foods we eat and the oxygen we breathe. Almost all the sugars in food are converted into glucose, the fuel in our muscles. So carbohydrates, so many things out there. Don't eat carbs. Carbs are bad. Carbs are not bad. Carbs are okay.
Thank you.
Carbs provide energy for food function and activity by supplying immediate calories. Carbs are stored in the liver and in our muscles as glycogen. Our amazing bodies transform glycogen in the liver into glucose for release into the bloodstream when it's needed for energy. Thank you, body. Not all carbs are created equal. Here's the difference. And I broke it down for you as gasoline. Premium gasoline. Complex carbs. unrefined sugars, not processed, not man-made. Would those carbs be good?
Yeah.
Would taste good? Yeah.
No, would they be good for us?
Yes.
Because like premium gas.
Premium gas, unrefined sugars, not processed, not man-made.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Yeah. I heard that.
That's okay.
I was like, no.
We want that. Yeah, we don't want anything processed. You're like, wait. So these carbs are best for us. So here are some suggestions. Have you guys heard of Ezekiel bread? Okay. Ezekiel bread is made from sprouted grains. It means that they didn't take the wheat and process the bejesus out of it, right? So sprouted grains. Look on your package. Look on your packaging for sprouted, right? Sprouted is good. Look on your packaging for anything that says organic. Organic means that it's not GMO, right? It's not genetically modified. Sprouted grains, okay? What are some other good complex carbs? Anybody want to shout out good complex carbs?
Like legumes.
Legumes, okay. Yeah, good source of fiber.
Is a pea a bean or not?
Peas can be beans. Yeah, legume, it like fall into that category. Yep. Sweet potatoes, oats, non-starchy vegetables, green beans, Brussels sprouts, celery, tomatoes. Look for words on the package like sprouted grains and organic. So these are our premium gasoline. This is what we want to put in our body, right? My sweet, sweet husband just brought me a sandwich because I didn't eat all day. And I said, please make sure it's on whole grain bread, loaded up with veggies and sprouts. And I did have some lean turkey on it. But even though Jimmy John's has some really delicious what is it called? What's there? A French bread.
Yeah.
Sometimes we do that, right? Sometimes we splurge the 80-20 rule. That's okay. But for the most part, we want to stick to that, something that will give our body fuel and energy, right? Okay. So regular gas. We just moved on from premium gas to regular gas. Unavailable carbs. Fiber from foods. These carbs we need to eat from the earth for cellulose and fiber to help with elimination, aka pooping. I have never talked about poop so much in my life as moving into natural medicine. If you guys want to talk to me about your poop, I'm here for it because pooping is important. Choose organic apples, broccoli, carrots, pears, and berries if you need organic, natural, from the earth ways to get fiber. Chia seeds, awesome form of cellulose, awesome form of fiber. This pack of chia seeds is from Costco. It shows you the fiber, good source of iron, gluten-free, good source of calcium, omega-3s. See that big word at the top, organic. We want that organic. We're going to do a fun experiment tonight. This is a form of fiber, and it's also going to fall into our herb discussion. This is psyllium husk, and this is water. So I'm going to pass this around, and I'm going to have a few of you, let's have you two open up one of these capsules and put it in here. Okay, you're going to stir it around, and then Allison, I'll have you open up the third capsule, and then you'll kind of pass around and stir it. So by the time we get to herbs, I want you guys to see what happens to the psyllium husk, okay? Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about that, okay? So at any point between now and then, you just open up a capsule and just kind of pop one open. These are just from the health food store. Open one and stick it in. Okay. All right. So that is regular gas. Now, low grade gasoline would be wah wah. All the good stuff we love to eat, right? Simple sugars, refined sugars, man-made sugars. These carbs are processed, often packaged in plastic, loaded with preservatives and fillers that do our bodies no favors. C-section pee on processed foods. Well, we might get that today. If we don't, we don't. We crave this type of fuel because it releases high amounts of energy at quick rates. So we feel a burst of energy, and then what happens?
We crash.
Right. In reality, the repeated burst and crash from these foods is pulling important nutrients from our bodies, and we can't run our engine sufficiently. So even though it feels good in the moment, it's not so good for later.
It's pulling what from our bodies?
It's pulling important nutrients. So Emily's question was, simple sugars are pulling what from our bodies? And the answer to that is nutrients. And the reason why is because when we eat Doritos or Starburst or cookies, we get that real quick burst of energy, right? And then we crash. And in order for our bodies to kind of make up for what just happened, they're trying to send nutrients to the places of our bodies that are exhausted. Maybe it's our adrenals. Maybe it's our thyroid. Because our body, if all you ate was processed food, your body would start to pull minerals and nutrients from anywhere that it could in order to stay alive. Because our body is very smart and our body wants to survive. So somebody that has osteoporosis, for example, it's been a lifetime of pulling calcium from their bones because they need it in other places of their body. And their body goes, well, we don't really need my teeth as much as I need my kneecap. So I'm going to pull it from my teeth and send it to my kneecap. The body's really smart. Does that make sense? It's all connected. It's all connected. So that really is why when they say you are what you eat, it's not like you drive through the drive-thru at McDonald's and you eat a burger one time and you're just going to perish. No, it's you are what you eat on a consistent basis, right? Okay. So hopefully that makes sense. Okay, so we're talking about F. The food sources, the food groups, food types. We just covered carbs. So the next letter or the next part of food groups is fats. Okay, so you guys were all on page 7. Yeah. So fats provide more than twice the amount of calories and energy per gram than carbohydrates. So did we all know this? Okay. Fats are found in both animals and vegetables. Fats are not water soluble. And this is important for two reasons. First, the structure of the body is made with fats, such as cell walls, the myelin sheath covering your nerves, and connective tissues, which are all in the presence of water and need to keep the structure intact. The second is not a benefit, but it's important. Since water, the most readily available fluid in the body, cannot dissolve fat, it needs enzymes and must go through a process called emulsification to break down fats or to remain soluble and not clog our bodies. Sorry, this is a little wordy, but I'm going to get through it. Fat reacts with cholesterol in our bodies, making it sticky and clogging our arteries. We produce about 60% of our own cholesterol, and the rest comes from food. Did you guys know that? We produce 60% of our own cholesterol, and the rest comes from food. That's important. Important to know. We produce cholesterol because we need it. We need it. So cholesterol is not the bad guy, but an excess of it can cause problems. Letter C is on cholesterol. So when we get to C, I have a printout for you guys on cholesterol. We might not read it. It's a lot, but just know that you have an entire handout on why cholesterol is a good guy. Okay, so types of fat are saturated, solid at room temperature. Name a saturated fat. Coconut oil, great one. That's a good one for us too.
That's the one I was thinking. But
coconut oil. Butter. Butter, yeah, butter.
Not like an avocado oil.
Hard. Avocado oil, does that get hard at room temperature? I don't think avocado oil does. It doesn't because I have some in my cupboard. That one, I know it's that one you would think though because it's more of like a solid fat.
Crisco.
But any Crisco, yeah. Unsaturated is liquid at room temperature. So that would be like olive oil, right? Avocado oil, yeah. Fat terms, LDL, low density lipoprotein. It takes fat from the liver and deposits it to the body. So I wanted to mention that because when you guys go to the doctor, they tell you HDL is the good cholesterol. It's happy. H, happy. LDL is the bad cholesterol. You just remember it's the opposite of happy. And then you've got your triglycerides and they go, well, your number's high or your number's low, but they don't exactly tell you what LDL or HDL is all the time, right? So LDL takes fat from our liver, which is the right side, right, Allison? Liver, and deposits it to the body. High density lipoprotein picks up the fat and brings it back. So both are important part of the fat cycle in our bodies, and we need both to transport fat. So you can kind of think of it like a transport system. So we'll dive into cholesterol a little bit more in the packet of information. So if you guys have any questions about fat, you can write them down. Or if there's a fat question just burning you up right now, you go ahead and ask it. Nobody. Okay. All right. Proteins. How many of you knew proteins are amino acids? Proteins are amino acids, right? So I love talking about this stuff because I love working out. I love fitness. I love movement and being healthy. And in that world, in any world we live in, it's all about high protein diets and low carbs and, you know, this is good and that's bad. And you need to eat this amount of protein to have muscle mass. And well, that's all good and fine. We actually know what it's doing to our bodies. What if we actually ate from a standpoint of what's happening chemically and physiologically in our bodies? Mm-hmm. It would really change the game. And so that's why I wanted to break down for you guys. When you eat anything, it has carbs, protein, and fat in it, right? So let's know what they are. So amino acids, when you look in the mirror, hi, you're looking at amino acids. I should have brought you all a mirror. The structure of the body is built on amino acids mixed with minerals. Isn't that cool? The structure of the body is built on amino acids mixed with minerals. Amino acids are in the form of protein, form a matrix. You know, like a little grid, a little matrix grid. And in between those little matrix grids are minerals. The amount and mixture of the minerals in the grid determine the characteristics and structure. For example, bone is protein filled with calcium and phosphorus. So you got your bone matrix, your amino acids, and it's filled with calcium and phosphorus to keep our bones strong. Does that make sense? Oh, we have a question.
So if I eat my protein, I don't ever have to worry about my bones going weak. It's like, my bones will be happy.
So the question is, if I eat my protein, I won't ever have to worry about my bones going weak. Well, not necessarily, because we're going to talk about this, but what kind of proteins you're eating matter. Like, what blood type are you?
I think I'm A negative.
A negative. Okay. So we'll get into this, but A type bloods don't necessarily like red meat. It's not good for your body. So a better source of protein would be like salmon or tofu. So to answer your question, yes, you should be eating your protein, but what kind you're eating matters to your own specific body. So just like these snowflakes that are in the room, each of our bodies, you know, no two snowflakes are the same. Each of our bodies have different needs. So Emily, do you eat a lot of protein?
Yeah. I'm working on it.
You're working on it.
I was just going to say, no, she's
working on it.
She didn't answer quickly. That's how you know.
I know how much I'm supposed to be eating, but getting there is.
How much are you supposed to be eating?
I think it's like 30 grams per meal. I did a whole
spreadsheet. Okay, 30 grams per meal.
It's interesting to get all the way there. You know?
Okay, so we'll talk about this, but the rule of thumb that I came across, it's on the bottom of page 9. How much protein should we be eating? A good rule of thumb is to divide your body weight in half, and that's the approximate number of grams of protein you need on a daily basis. So if I'm 100 pounds, you should be getting 50 grams of protein. Was that about where you're at? Okay, that kind of makes sense. So that's a good rule of thumb. Now, where that protein's coming from all depends on your body, right? Did that answer it?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So proteins, amino acids, help the body use nutrients and maintain proper fluid levels. Molecules are always being broken down and replaced. We essentially have a new body every year. Isn't that cool? We essentially have a new body every year. So if you're one of those people that's like, oh, I've never eaten healthy, I've never worked out a day in my life, it's too late.
Can you say the beginning of that again?
Yeah.
Like, we have a new body every year, but why? Say the why part.
I'm going to break it down. I'll break it down for you.
So, page eight.
Proteins at the top of page 8, proteins, aka amino acids, this grid we're talking about, help the body use nutrients and maintain proper fluid levels. Molecules are always being broken down and replaced. So essentially, we have a new body every year. I'll help clarify that. Okay, about 330 billion cells are replaced daily. 330 billion cells are replaced daily, equivalent to 1% of all of our cells. 1% of our cells is 330 billion cells. Holy moly, that is nuts. In 80 to 100 days, so 3 months, right? 80 to 100 days, 30 trillion will have been replenished, the equivalent of a new you.
In 30 days?
So we essentially have a new body every year.
3 months.
They're saying, but your cells, on a cellular level, you have new cells every 3 months. So I think what they're saying is every 3 months you have all new cells, but by the end of a year, you pretty much have a new you because your cells have all just been turning over all the time. Does that make more sense that way? Mm-hmm. Okay. So since we are made of trillions of cells, the structure of which is mainly protein, right? We looked in the mirror and said, hi, amino acids. You can see the need for a constant supply of protein in our diet, right? So we need that protein. Of all the amino acids, 20 serve as the building blocks of protein. So 20 serve as the building blocks of protein. These are known as the standard amino acids. They include, I could read all these words, histidine, isoleucine, lysine, they're all in there. So in case you haven't figured it out, we are miraculous. God created an incredibly smart system. And when we work with our bodies, not against them, amazing things happen. So Emily, this will also kind of hammer it home for you guys. A single meal, depending on its protein and carbohydrate content, can rapidly influence the uptake of amino acids into the brain and directly modify their conversion to neurotransmitters. Dysfunction in the neurotransmitter synthesis is related to mood disorders. The most studied amino acid tryptophan works as a precursor for serotonin, which is known to play a key role in mood disorders. So just kind of driving home how important it is to eat protein. We don't just eat protein because we're supposed to eat protein. We eat protein because we actually need it for the neurotransmitters in our brains, right? Just like we need fats for our brains.
And that's where the brain
fog could. It could. Yeah, brain fog could come from a lot of different places. Hi, come on in. Come on in. You can find a seat wherever there's a packet. You can sit right here. Come on in. We are on page 8, talking about protein and amino acids. So dopamine is produced from amino acids, tyrosine and phenylalanine, which can be obtained from protein-rich foods. Very high intakes of these amino acids may boost dopamine levels. So you guys have heard of, like, you know, when people have depression or anxiety or different mood disorders, that maybe there's a depletion of serotonin, maybe there's a depletion of dopamine, which dopamine is our, what's the word I'm looking for? What's dopamine, guys?
Is it like our helps to be upbeat?
Yeah, helps us to be upbeat. It's our pleasure. Yes, thank you. Pleasure, happiness, pleasure. That's a good word for it. And serotonin is the same. So the foods we eat and the brain fog that we are maybe talking about really can be healed from the foods that we're eating. So just kind of driving that home. Amino acids participate in a range of functions of the brain, such as regulation of mood, certain neurotransmitters, serotonin, dopamine, noradrenaline, and GABA have a role in the pathogenesis of mood disorders. Okay, so going down that path again. All right, so we're kind of in the middle of page 9. I'm in the middle of page 9. Animal proteins are harder to digest and require a lot of energy to break down. Also, more often than not, digestion is incomplete, causing toxins to build up in the body. Additionally, cholesterol in saturated fats, which are found in flesh protein, have no fiber. Okay, so animal proteins, okay. All right, it's a source of protein, right? Animal proteins or flesh proteins are similar to the makeup of a human. This type of protein is considered a complete protein. It has everything it needs. Plants, on the other hand, are a good supply of protein but are incomplete and not similar to humans. So if we were to just kind of compare and contrast, vegetable proteins help lower cholesterol have unsaturated fats and contain all natural fiber. So what would be a good idea? Should we maybe get a mix of both? Wouldn't that be a good idea? Right? So again, depending on your body, what if somebody's a vegetarian and they don't want to eat any meat? Would they be getting enough protein?
Yes.
They're eating the vegetables.
Mm-hmm. They might have to eat more vegetables.
Yes, more, definitely. Mm-hmm.
I love this answer. Huge misconception. You eat both, you eat a little bit of meat and lots of veggies, you're going to get a wonderful array of protein, some from flesh protein, some from plant protein, right? If that works for your body, right? If it works for your blood type, if it works for your composition, if it works for your palate. If you're vegetarian or vegan and you absolutely will not eat flesh protein, it's okay. Eat a variety of plants. Eat as much of the rainbow as you can. And then get your legumes and your beans, and you can get protein from broccoli and spinach and all these vegetables. They have protein. Like if I were to show you a chart of protein in veggies, you'd probably go, there's a lot of vegetables that have protein. So although veggies are not a complete protein, this can be overcome by eating a wide variety of veggies, nuts, and seeds. Veggies, nuts, and seeds. Pumpkin seeds. Yum, yum, yum. So pumpkin seeds, 8 grams of protein. Remember that word sprouted that we talked about? What does sprouted mean? Processed. Yeah.
If it doesn't say sprouted, then it is probably
processed. Not necessarily. If it says organic, it's your best. Look for the word organic or sprouted. I mean, if you're going to go on a road trip and you have non-organic, non-sprouted pumpkin seeds sitting next to you, and McDonald's French fries, we're going to go for the pumpkin seeds, right? So we just have to use common sense too. Another thing pumpkin seeds are good for, raise your hand if you know.
People use it
for what? Prostate, you said? Oh, okay, prostate, I like that.
Aren't they? Fiber.
Fiber, let's see how
aren't
much fiber.
They like,
3 grams of fiber.
Don't they make you happy? There's some kind of chemical in some
happiness.
They make you.
They
no,
should
I'm
put that on the package.
No, I'm very serious. Like it boosts.
Okay.
Here,
it might.
Isn't it high in calcium?
Potassium or it is high in magnesium. High in manganese. Mm-hmm. High in copper.
A lot of minerals.
Zinc. Lots of minerals. You know what else these are good for? Mm-hmm. Parasites.
Parasites.
So eat a handful of these a day if you have animals, if you have pets at your home. We might have those little buggers in our bellies because everyone has some sort of parasite. Think about it. The world we live in, the soil we walk on, the pets we pet, the animals we're around, the things we're around. I mean, those little buggers are bound to get in there. Here's the key. Don't give them a hospitable environment to live in, right? Let's make it hard for them to live in there by eating pumpkin seeds and probiotics and kombucha and things that are like the little buggers don't want to live in there. All right, Allison's giggling. What'd you find?
It says, because we were talking about it,
Googled
it. It says, in fact, pumpkin seeds have been shown to improve heart health, blood sugar levels, fertility.
Yes.
And sleep quality.
I mean, these are like some powerhouses here. I'm going to pass around these pumpkin seeds. You guys are more than welcome to scoop some out. Wiggle some on your napkin or your plate. So you said heart disease, fertility.
Quality sleep. And blood sugar,
parasites, prostate, pumpkin seeds, all the peas. These bad boys are awesome. Okay. Here we go. You guys can pass them around. I got those at Costco. Okay. Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah.
I mean, this stuff lights me up in case you can't tell. Oh, look. We have a picture. Finally, we have a picture. Okay. So on page 10, foods rich in amino acids. When we eat raw plant foods, the amino acids are intact and usable by our bodies. Let me read that again. When we eat raw plants, the amino acids, what's an amino acid?
A protein,
are intact. They're in there. They're ready to go. And they can be assimilated into our bodies. Celery, Yeah, he doesn't want any pumpkin seeds. So that's fine. Thank you. Celery, quinoa, coconuts, cabbage, almonds, garlic, cucumbers, green leaves, ginger, radishes. Oh, you guys are going to see alfalfa on here about 700 times. Alfalfa is like power food. Alfalfa. I actually have a protein powder. Dr. D's been drinking it too. It has alfalfa in it. So you could have your alfalfa with your protein every day. So here's your list. Okay. So we jumped from A to F. Do you guys like that we've only covered two letters of the alphabet? Do you see what I mean? What time is it? Okay, perfect. 45 minutes. And what's your name?
Debbie.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Happy you're here. I'm Alicia. Okay, so we're going to jump from F to D, according to my calculations here. But before I do that, did anybody write down a question that they need answered? Yes.
Oh, complete. I heard the term, maybe we covered it and I missed it. Something about complete protein.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the essential amino acids are considered complete protein?
Okay, so this is the question. The question is, what's a complete protein and are essential amino acids a complete protein? Okay, so a complete protein would be considered a flesh protein from an animal because animal protein is very comparable to humans, and we have complete protein. So when you eat animal protein, it's a complete protein. When you eat plant proteins, let's say I'm gnawing on broccoli, it's not a complete protein. It's not a complete protein. It has a kind of protein in it, but not a complete protein. So that's why I have to pair some celery and some tomatoes and some other things with it to make it complete. And I love this question because these super aminos, I didn't even know about taking amino acids until a couple years ago. And these amino acids, the reason that these were recommended, this program that I joined, had you drink green shakes in addition to eating healthy foods, avocados and Ezekiel toast and things like that, but no meat. This particular program that I was on was all veggie-based and no meat. And I was like, okay, well, they sent me these amino acids with this program. Why am I taking these amino acids? So researching, it's because I'm not eating complete protein. I'm eating veggies galore, which are so good for me in every way, shape, or form, but I'm not getting the essential amino acids. I could be, but I would have to eat a lot of veggies to get those, right? So this is like everything that we're talking about is like absolute best case scenario. Like if I could eat an essential amino acid and complete protein with this array of veggies, I would do it. But could we really do that every day?
All you really was eat.
Okay, if all you did was eat. If all you did was eat.
Plan what you're gonna
which eat. Is also why people juice, which J is for juice. In your packet, it's also why people juice, because if you juice 8 pounds of veggies and fruit and you drink it
a day,
because it mushes down, right? Mm-hmm. You're going to be consuming all those minerals and vitamins and essential, you know, amino acids. So an amino acid too, this is really good for you guys to know, starts with an L. So on the packaging, I'll pass this around for you guys to see. So L-leucine, L-valine, I'm probably not saying these right. L-isoleucine, L-lysine, L-phenylalanine, L-threonine. So when you see it on the packaging, and I'll pass that back to you, you can see that amino acid. Did that answer it for you? Did that answer the question?
It did very
okay.
Well.
And I love that you asked that because I didn't even realize that really. I mean, I knew about it, but I didn't really understand it until, you know, several months ago. So hello. Come on in. We're having a riveting discussion on amino acids.
Can't wait.
There's a packet in front of you. So we just finished up talking about protein, carbs, and fats. So what other questions on proteins, carbs, and fats?
Do you need me to get more people?
Oh, we're good. Thank you.
Account?
Yeah, we're good. We're good. Thank you so much. Thank you guys all for being here. All good. All right, should we move on? Okay, we're going to move on. So we're going to jump around. Now, just to remind those of you that just walked in, write your questions down. There's pens and pencils kind of scattered around the room. And I'm going to go through a couple letters of the alphabet, and then we'll come back to questions, okay? So we're going to jump to D. D, depression and diseases. Why would letter D be depression and diseases if we're in a nutrition workshop?
Anybody? Because we can eradicate them.
Yes. Because we can eradicate depression and diseases with?
Our food choices.
The foods we eat. Oh my gosh, right? Starting with our babies, starting with our kids. Let's be the example of that. We can learn all of this goodness in class tonight and take it out and tell our friends about it and help so many kids with this. Depression and diseases can be healed with foods. C-section on amino acids. We just covered that. But they can also be healed by understanding how we store emotions. Depression is suppressed or repressed anger. Can everyone say that? Depression is suppressed or repressed anger. Whoa. Goosebumps. Depression is suppressed or repressed anger, and emotions are energy in motion. There's a book called Molecules of Emotions. I haven't read it, but it was recommended to me, and apparently it's all about this. We have to move emotions somehow and get them out of our bodies. So just like we talked about elimination, it's important to poop. You guys all kind of laughed at me, but it's super important to poop. We have to eliminate all of these stuck emotions too. We have to get them out of our bodies, whether it's movement and exercise or talking about them or expressing ourselves and being allowed to express ourselves. Or if we were a child, that maybe we were the youngest, and we were never allowed to have a voice in our family. And it came all the way back from that time in our life. And we grew up and we just don't feel like we can have a voice and we can't speak what we need. It's going to internalize itself. And as much as you have shoved it down there, it's going to start showing up in the way we eat, in the choices that we make when we eat, in the choices in our relationship, and everything that we do. So, simply stated, disease means that the body is in a state of imbalance. Dis-ease. The body is in a state of dis-ease. Break down the word. Separate it. So, addressing the emotional side of depression and disease, don't give emotional control to others. Easier said than done. Mm-hmm. Instead of saying, "You made me so angry," say, "I choose to be angry." And notice how it starts to change your emotional patterns. Instead of, "You make me so happy," say, "Being with you makes me happy." Allow yourself and your children to feel and move through every emotion so we don't get stuck in depression, anger, resentment, people-pleasing, etc. Pro tip. Here's a pro tip. Vitamin B3 and vitamin B9 may also help people with depression because B vitamins help the brain manage moods. Vitamin D, melatonin, and St. John's wort are also recommended for seasonal depression. Omega-3 fatty acids, magnesium, and vitamin C may also help with depression. So notice how I ended with supplementing. Because we can supplement all day long. We can take antidepressant medications. And I'm preaching to the choir here. I'm somebody that has suffered from postpartum depression. I'm somebody that suffered with depression in my life. And let me tell you that I've made it my mission to heal myself so that I can heal others. And if I wouldn't have done the work to move those emotions, that repressed anger, I would be in a whole state of trouble. You know, it's ongoing work. It's ongoing. It doesn't just happen overnight. But we have to address what's going on in ourselves, in our bodies, and then also think about the nutrition side of it. So does anybody have a burning question on that?
have a comment.
Yeah, please.
I have found as I've gotten older, and I wish I would have done this younger, but when I am feeling angry or stressed, I go outside and I go for a really good walk, and that just helps me so much. I can't even tell you how it helps me, like, sort through some emotions, but also like my breathing, because I think when we get angry or we're feeling stressed, like I can feel like my heart or my chest getting tighter, like just the tightness of that. Mm-hmm. I feel like even our posture kind of closes in.
Mm-hmm.
And by getting out and walking, it kind of opens me up and just gets me where I'm breathing more.
Amen.
So it really has helped me.
So going outside, taking a walk, getting back to nature, getting off our phones, reconnecting with ourselves. Everything you just said is so right on. And just breathing. I mean, I have helped so many kids just breathe. Like, they're in a state of distress. They can't calm themselves down and just, okay, just calm down, take 5 breaths and breathe. Then maybe go for your walk. Because when you're walking, you're breathing too. You're focused on your step and your rhythm and your, you know, all of it. So you bring up a really great point, Allison. Thank you. Any other coping mechanisms for depression or anger or anything that's worked for you guys that could maybe help others?
I've heard, I have the reverse problem with buying chocolate.
Chocolate triggers depression?
No, actually anger.
Oh, anger. Interesting.
We noticed that. It's me as a pattern that surface, but that seems to be.
What kind of chocolate?
Belgian chocolate, Trader Joe's.
Okay. I wonder if it's a milk thing.
Oh, yeah, because dairy is not true.
Well, dairy, if we were to cover, you know, we could do a whole thing on dairy, but you know, from the cow, unpasteurized, really good for us, dairy is a whole different category of what they do to dairy and then how they put it in chocolate. You have a intolerance to dairy, you know, it could. I don't know. I mean, we could definitely talk about it more, but that could very well be why. I know for me personally, dairy gives me brain fog. I'm a hot mess when I eat dairy. I also, it doesn't do well with my stomach, but I think it's because what we've done to it, just like what we've done to our wheat, you know, what we've done to our corn. Holy poop. There's an example in here of what we've done to our corn. You know, we take this beautiful corn on the cob that is harvested, and let's say we got lucky and it wasn't sprayed with GMOs, you know? So then, okay, we take this corn and then we can it. We put it in an aluminum container, right? Then we ship it to a store. And then sometimes we take that corn and we turn it into Doritos. And so by the time we eat the corn, it's been picked and processed and it's not even corn anymore, you know? And like, that's what we've done to our food. So that would make sense that, you know, maybe chocolate. I'm sorry, chocolate makes you angry. That's not good. Yeah, something to look into for sure. Thank you for that. Any other comments or questions on D? D is not for donuts. Sorry, D is not for donuts. Come on in. All right, so we're jumping around. We went from A for make sure you're your own advocate, to F, which was all of our food sources, carbohydrates, fats, proteins, to D, which was depression and diseases. We're going to jump to E. Oh, man, E is a long one. But E is about energy. Who wants to learn about energy? Yay, energy. I'm going to grab a sip of water because H is for hydration.
Hydration is important.
Right? So H on your list is for hydration, and there's an entire handout on hydration. Did you guys know that arthritis is a lifetime of dehydration?
What? Say that again.
Whoa! Arthritis is a lifetime of dehydration. Your cells are hydrated.
Hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So how much water are you supposed to be having?
At least half your body weight in ounces every day. At least. And if you drink a cup of coffee, one cup of coffee, it's 3 cups of water.
What did you say?
I know. I know. I'm not going to be your friend for a minute.
Say it again.
One cup of coffee. Drink your coffee. That's fine. But then you got to drink 3 extra cups of water. And don't even get me started on pop. No one in this room is allowed to drink pop. I drink 1 Diet Coke in the course of my almost 2 years at this school. And this man in the back rode me the whole day. You are not drinking Diet Coke. I can't believe you're drinking Diet Coke. And he was right. He was super right. Because it's so bad for us. It's so bad for us. Don't drink pop.
So half your weight.
Okay, so half your weight in ounces of water every single day. So if I am 100 pounds, I need to drink 50 ounces of water.
What if you're one that can't because you don't want to leave your class?
Because then you have to miss the bathroom. You're going to have to go to the bathroom.
Tell your friends to come down and watch your kids.
So you're going to be hydrated. You're going to have less of a chance of disease. You're going to have a higher immune system. You're going to miss less work. You're going to feel so much better, even though you're going to be running to the bathroom. You're going to have to tell the kids, sorry, kids, sit down and write uno, dos, tres, cuatro, cinco, seis 5 more times because I got to pee. So it's just going to have to be the way.
All the offices.
I know.
I know. It does make you have to pee a lot, but I drink a ton of water. On the days that I don't, I can totally tell the difference. The other thing I was just talking to someone in the office about is collagen. Who are we talking about collagen?
Kristen?
Someone, it doesn't matter. Someone came in the office and we were talking about collagen. Maybe it was. And like this controversy about if you drink collagen, is it actually doing anything? Or by the time it gets through your stomach acid and your colon, is it actually like assimilating into your body? Because as we get older, we lose the collagen in our skin, right? Well, what's going to keep your skin supple and plump?
Water.
Water, right? Somehow we jumped to hydration. We must have needed to talk about hydration, but
well, you were getting your water.
You know what? Let's just jump to hydration. Let's find that insert really quick since we're there. So in the back of your packet, it goes cholesterol, blood type, cholesterol, vitamin B17. Then hydration. Do you guys all see it? It's not in the stapled packet. It's in the handout.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
it's in the handout. And God knows what he's doing. He knew we needed to jump to hydration. So that's okay. We'll come back to energy. Is everybody doing okay? Do you guys need a potty break? Okay.
You must not be drinking.
I know. I'm going to start chugging. Okay, so I tried to make these handouts to something where you guys could just go copy them if you wanted to hand them out to your friends. But hydration. It takes 21 days to hydrate. Okay, so start your habit now. 21 days to hydrate.
Okay. Is it all that easy for what's the title
called? Oh, hydration at the top. Yeah.
Oh. Find it.
Agreed. Avoid
plastic bottles.
I'm gonna
grab.
It's BPA free.
Yeah.
21 days to hydrate. Babe, I might just have to borrow yours if that's okay. Okay, I'll give it back. I promise. Okay, so 21 days to hydrate. Dry sponge analogy. Think of a sponge, right? Like one of those little yellow sponges that we scrub our dishes with. Think of it when it's all dried out. Okay, does everybody picture it? That's our skin and our cells when we don't drink water. Then when you run that sponge under the water and the sponge gets all gushy, and that's our skin. I mean, that's the easiest way to think of it. The sponge that's hydrated is our skin. The sponge that's not, when you start to get all, you know, dry and it shows. So drinking half your body weight in ounces. We talked about that. The skin is 70% water. A sprinkle of sea salt and purified water to remineralize. A squeeze of lemon or lime in your water at restaurants will absorb the chlorine in 5 minutes.
Interesting.
Isn't that cool? So my friends and I at school, after we learned this, we all went out to dinner. We went to a Mexican restaurant.
which is like, what can we actually eat?
But we squeezed the lemons in our water, and I was like, I'm really thirsty. I really want to drink it. And they're like, no, you have to wait 5 minutes because it's getting rid of the chlorine.
Yeah,
like, awesome. Set the timer. But I've also been drinking lemon water every morning because lemon water, first thing in the morning, cleanses your liver.
Interesting. What about carbonated water? Do you know anything about that?
All I know about carbonated water is that it strips your phosphorus. Okay, but here's what I love about carbonated water. Carbonated water, especially like Spindrift. Spindrift is one of the better brands, more high quality brands. If you were to choose sparkling water over drinking alcohol or sparkling water over pop, such a better choice. And I think you'd have to drink, Allison, I think you'd have to drink a ton of sparkling water to deplete your phosphorus, you know.
Well, we have a soda stream, and we've been doing the carbonated water every day in place of regular water, like all the time.
Well, so let's eat stuff with phosphorus then. What has phosphorus in it? I have to go back and look at my chart. I'll tell you.
Okay.
I'll give you some phosphorus foods. That'll be your homework.
Yeah. Well, I've been eating sardines since you told me, so.
Yeah, perfect. Okay, so 5 minutes of lemon or lime in your water at restaurants absorbs the chlorine. Yay. Avoid ice or plastic straws at restaurants because they contaminate your water.
Okay, so the reason why I use the straw is I don't want to put my lips in the cup of May or Nancy.
Yeah, but what if the plastic straw has phytoplastics in it and it's leaking phytoplastics into your water? Again, this is super extreme. This is like, you have to pick and choose your battles here. You're not going to walk away tonight and, like, the fact that I love it. At the school, we implemented no microwave. We replaced the microwave with an air fryer because we learned that microwaves can do a lot of damage, right? So if the next thing you do is, like, maybe you bring your own metal straw or something. I don't know. But
I am failing at life.
You are not failing. No, no. Listen, in the 5 months that I've been going to this school, I've come home and implemented one thing every time.
Oh,
and my lovely husband here has been along for the whole ride. Like, we started with the microwave, right? We started no microwave, which my boys are so good about because our family loves microwave popcorn. So instead, we got one of those fun little air poppers.
Oh, yeah.
I found it at a retail shop for $2.99, straight out of the 1970s, right? Or you pop it on the range. So just point is, implement one thing at a time. Don't let this information overwhelm you so much that you're like, I'm failing.
I gave up pop, okay?
I am so
that's
proud
so
of you
good.
For giving up pop.
Emily,
how many days?
So
eight.
That's really good.
That's huge. That is huge. I'm
so
very
Helen
proud
and I did give up the microwave. We have been microwaving. I mean, we have been cooking everything.
Good.
Even our, when we like warm syrup on our pancakes.
Yeah.
We have even warmed it on the stove.
I'm so proud of you guys.
It's getting
or
like, okay, it takes everything.
So microwaves deplete 96% of the nutrients. It does a whole host of other things, but that's what you need to know. Microwaves. So think of it this way. You have this lovely, beautiful soup that you worked so hard on, and it's got all these delicious vegetables that you grew in your garden because now we're growing all of our own food, right? And then it's got a chicken that we went out and we plucked and we killed it and cut it up and put it in our soup. No, that's really extreme, right? But we make we make this beautiful homemade soup, and then we stick it in the microwave. We warm it up. And it doesn't have, it does us no good. It tastes okay. It tastes good, but doesn't have any nutrients. So don't do that to yourself. Warm it up on the stove. Okay. So back to hydration. Don't drink tap or well water. Avoid plastic bottles. This is all doom and gloom. It's all doom and gloom. Plastic mimics estrogen in the body. It can lead to estrogen-driven cancers. One cup of coffee loses 6 cups of water. I told you guys 3. Just go with 3. 3 is a little more easy to manage. But why does it say do not drink tap or well water?
Yeah, why does
it? Yeah.
Well, I know that there's fluoride and chlorine in your water.
Fluorine and chloride in our water. Oh, yes, correct.
Chlorine
in city water.
Yeah, in city water. Why shouldn't we drink well water?
Because there's
fluoride.
Fertilizer from farms, and there's also
you need to have your water tested.
Yeah. Yeah. Good answer. Maybe lead. Right. Okay. So what Kevin just said is we need to have our water tested. So again, going back to common sense, everyone in this room has common sense, right? So if we have our water tested and we learn that there's fluoride and chlorine, and actually there's websites you can go to see if your city water has fluorine or chloride in it or how much it does. But if you test your well water and it's got lead or high amounts of something else, then you just know what you're ingesting. So when the experts say don't drink city water or well water, it's simply because you could be ingesting medicine people dumped on the toilet. You could be ingesting GMOs that have run off of crops into your water. You could be ingesting all of these things, which is why there's water filters, right? Now, the one thing I will tell you that I learned at school. So microwave was the first thing to go. The second thing to go at our house was fluoride toothpaste.
Yeah.
We stopped using fluoride altogether. Which I will not get into entirely today, but we can talk about it offline if you'd like to. But there is fluoride in most city water, and fluoride can do a lot of harm to the body. You know, the DDA that, you know, when you go to the dentist, they'll put it on your teeth and they'll say you need it for your teeth, but to the detriment of your body. So that's all I'll say about that for now. But yeah, question.
Can I make a comment? Kevin and I have not been using fluoride toothpaste or fluoride for probably about 7 years, maybe 5 years.
Okay.
And
I have
felt so good.
Okay.
In the last 5 years health wise. And but they will try at your dentist. I mean, they will. My sister's a dentalist.
Yeah.
The dental community, they live and die by fluoride.
Yeah.
I mean, they really do, but it displaces a lot of things that your thyroid needs.
Yes.
And so, but it's possible. I get all my toothpaste at Marshall's.
Oh,
and a lot of it's
cool.
From Australia.
Okay.
And it's like $3.99 to $5.99.
Okay.
And you just look at it and it says fluoride free or.
Yep.
So yeah, go to Marshall's.
So Allison was saying that her and her husband have never felt better. Stopped using fluoride 5 to 7 years ago. Fluoride strips things from your thyroid and other parts of your body that you need. Our family just stopped using fluoride 4 months ago. I couldn't tell you if it's made a difference or not made a difference, but I will say that all of the things I've been implementing have made a difference. I mean, I definitely feel better, healthier, more energy, happier. Hello is my favorite brand of toothpaste. Called Hello. They have it at Target, non-fluoride. Something else really cool about fluoride, because I'm going to try and give you some hope too. not just all doom and gloom, but in the city of Mount Pleasant, the professor at my school that started Knight fought for years to get fluoride out of the water in the entire city of Mount Pleasant, and she won. She finally won because when they did end up taking it to court or to, you know, when they stood up to fight for it, her case was strong enough to show that it's more detrimental to the body, you know, than good. So, and you and I could probably get into that, but
displaces iodine.
The chemistry of it.
Iodine.
Yeah. Displaces iodine.
And also, what was the thing that Dr. Ray said? Didn't they use it in concentration camps?
That's what I'm saying. We could go down a major rabbit hole here, and
we won't.
Which is also why we're not going to talk about injections and viruses.
Yeah.
We won't go down that rabbit hole either. But hydration. Hydration. So any questions on hydration?
So
yeah.
If you're supposed to be careful not to drink well water, city water, or water out of plastic.
Yeah.
How do you get your water?
Yeah.
Like, where
yeah.
do you get it from? That's what I want to know.
What were you going to say?
The song where the kids open their mouth up.
Yeah.
Oh.
Because even if you start carrying around a glass water bottle, like, you have to get the water in that bottle from somewhere to begin with.
Yeah.
Like, if you're talking about where you should have your water tested at your house.
Yeah.
You know what's in your water at your home. And I would have your water tested at your work. If you drink a lot of water at work,
yeah.
Or bring a gallon jug of water from home
but then
in glass.
In glass,
if you can,
yeah.
If you can get a glass jar, which you can find them out there. But yeah, you just want to know, be as informed as you can about where your water's coming from.
What if your water source at home is like you have a problem with it and you don't want to drink that? Like, where should
you need to have either
you
like
get,
filtration system?
You can get
or,
the Capsule Pure, like steam distilled water from them as well. Because another naturopath doctor always told me that when it comes to hydration, that's all your body needs. You don't drink water for minerals. You don't drink water for anything else other than hydrogen and oxygen.
Mm-hmm. Well, so I think step one, get your water tested. And I think there are places that you can just take your water to in for free and they'll test your water for you. The other thing would be to get an at-home filtration system if you can afford it, if it's something that's within your means. The third way would just be an on-the-counter filtration system, so like a Brita.
Oh, I don't think
yeah,
that.
Just we have one in the kitchen here, too. Just get a Brita and fill it every day. Leave it on the counter. Mm-hmm. If you like cold water, put it in the fridge. And then just the thing is, be diligent. So I absolutely can't stand bottled water. And the number one reason I can't stand it is because of the waste. It's more about the waste for me than it is about the actual water. But do I drink bottled water? Yeah, occasionally, right? Because I'm in a pinch. So this is all like real life stuff. I don't want anybody to leave here tonight and go, that's not realistic. I can't do that. It has to be realistic for you, right? Mm-hmm. So if that means it's a Brita and not a whole house filtration system, reverse osmosis, wouldn't that be nice if we could all afford reverse osmosis systems, right? It'd be amazing. There's another one. I can't think of the name offhand. It's like a Brita and it's metal. It's like $250 price range. It's like top of the line, one of the best you can get, but it's much bigger than a Brita and you can get it and you can set it right on your counter. I can't think of the name of it. If I think of it, I'll mention it though.
Okay.
So, do you think that sounds realistic for you?
Well, it's a little more complicated, but so
yeah.
It'll take too long to explain.
Okay, sure. Yeah.
I'll tell you something creative that we did for a long time. Our Wixom City Water, where we used to live, it had fluoride added to it, and chlorine. And we would get our water from here where we work. We would just fill up giant containers of water.
Take 5 gallon.
5 gallon, jugs, and we would have that in our house. So let's say you have a friend that, like maybe your parents or, you know, maybe your church, I don't know, but to see if they have better water than you have. But like we would
fill it up
in a plastic jug. So
yeah.
It's
still better than drinking
plastic.
City water.
Yeah.
Drinking
yeah.
out of that plastic jug is still better than drinking city water.
And if you ate a totally clean diet and you upped your veggies, girl, and you were outside walking and you were taking care of yourself, and the only thing you didn't change was the water, like, that's okay. Do it one step at a time. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, not saying you shouldn't change your water, because we all should, but take it one step at a time if that's not the most realistic thing for you. And I love that suggestion. Go fill up at Emily's.
I was just going to say, she lives a mile from my house. And I have a pro system. I'm like, come fill
really?
Up at my house.
Come on in our kitchen every morning.
In my mind. Now, if I start doing all this stuff, am I going to get telepathy too? Because that was awesome.
Oh, yeah, maybe you will. Yep, swap out your fluoride toothpaste and it'll happen. Yeah, no water. I mean, we're so fortunate to live where we live, where we have access to water. Like if you look at it that way, right? Like all the missionaries in this room that have gone to places where you don't even have access to water.
Mm-hmm.
Like how fortunate are we? And you know, everything that happened in Flint with their water, you know, we have to choose our battles and we have to count our blessings. Mm-hmm. And then we have to find a way to make it realistic for us. Right. And, you know, another thing that I've led accountability groups when we talk about planning ahead for our meals, because in order to be successful with anything, it takes preparation. Right. So planning ahead with our water, planning ahead with our what we eat for lunch, planning ahead with our snacks. I mean, if I'm starving and the only thing in my car to eat is Pop-Tarts, it takes everything within me not to eat the Pop-Tart, right? Just don't have Pop-Tarts in your car. I guess that's the answer, right? Okay, so, woo! Anybody need a little break, a sip of water before I move on? We're good. Well, how are we doing on time? Cool. We're good. Good. Awesome. Are you guys learning new stuff?
Yes.
Okay, cool. All right, so we're going to jump to E. E for energy. I told you guys that there's no way we're going to get through the whole alphabet. There's just no way. Okay, so who wants more energy?
I do.
Right. I want more energy and more sleep, more vacation. Okay, energy. The thing that everyone wants more of besides sleep. So how do B vitamins help us get more energy? These vitamins help a variety of enzymes do their job, ranging from releasing energy from carbs and fat to breaking down amino acids. What are amino acids? Protein. And transporting oxygen and energy-containing nutrients around the body. B vitamins and vitamin C are water-soluble. We just got done talking about hydration. Not stored in the body and must be consumed every day. So vitamin B and C is something we need to take on a daily basis, whether it comes from food or supplements. So I think this is really cool, and I am confident every single one of you is going to learn something new about a B vitamin today, okay? Vitamin B1. All right, so let me preface this first by saying most vitamin B supplements come in a B complex format. So it's like a whole bunch of B's, right? You need a whole bunch of B's in one. So you've probably never sat down and broken down your B's. It's just not something we really do often. But I think it's cool so that you know the differences. So vitamin B1 is necessary for the body to make full use of carbohydrate intake. It strengthens the nervous system and can improve mental attitude. B1 is a helper for shingles, and regulating the heart, arrhythmias. Good sources of B1 are alfalfa, beans, and cauliflower. So just eat your alfalfa, beans, and cauliflower, and you'll be just fine, right?
You have fabulous breath.
You're going to have fabulous breath and stinky toots, but you're going to have a lot of energy. Right? Okay. B2 helps the body digest fats, proteins, and carbs and converts them to energy. Essential for the production of red blood cells and antibodies. The second greatest vitamin deficiency in the U.S. What's number one?
Vitamin D.
B2 is a helper for hair, skin, nails, eliminates dandruff, treats carpal tunnel. Good sources of B2.
Interesting.
Alfalfa, liver, fish, eggs, cayenne, and chamomile.
Alfalfa's like superfood.
Superfoods, right? B3, moving on, I'm on page three. B3, more energy, considered the courage or the happy vitamin. Necessary for proper brain function and healthy nervous system. Used in treating mental illness such as schizophrenia, anxiety, nervousness, and depression. B3 is a helper for hallucinations, digestion issues, reduces cholesterol, lessens migraines. Guess what? There's that word again. What's a good source of B3? Alfalfa, liver, fish, eggs, fennel seed, nettle, and rose hips. So B3 is niacin. Has anyone ever taken niacin?
My brother took it once on its own for fun when he was a kid.
Did he get the flop? Like the
his whole face, he goes to my mom and his whole face is like beet red. Yeah. She thought he had a fever.
Yeah.
And she's really scared of what was going on because he was
it flushes
so red.
It flushes out everything. Like it so you turn beet red and you get like this niacin tingle because it's like flushing things out of your body. So if you don't know, I'm just warning you of that in case y'all go try some niacin. That's why it's called
awful.
A full. Well, that's good for you.
Mom.
That's good for you.
Is it does it yeah. flush toxins out or like when you say it flushes things out of you?
Yeah, it's not listed as one of the things, but I would think it would. I mean, your whole body is
interesting.
Kind of like, because you start sweating too, really. I mean, that's a good question, though. I use the word flushing out, but I don't know if that's exactly what it does.
Interesting.
Proper brain function, healthy nervous system. There we go. helping your nervous system. B4, known for its role in speeding up the process in which energy is manufactured in the body, it plays a crucial role in protein synthesis and accompanying chemical processes. It's important for DNA and RNA. This is a big, long one. So what is B4 good for? It enriches our bodies by sources of B4, propolis, bee pollen, raw unprocessed honey. Eating a well-rounded diet of fresh fruit and veggies also helps us with a supply of B4. Herbs for B4, thyme, clove, sage, ginger, spearmint, jojoba, hawthorn, blessed thistle, just to name a few. So B4 is a powerhouse, right? That's pretty awesome. Bye, boys. Thank you for coming. Vitamin B5, necessary for production of hormones, converts fat, proteins, and carbs to energy. So you guys can see there's this reoccurring theme with all these B vitamins that they convert everything to energy in our bodies. B5 is a helper for arthritis, strengthens adrenals, prevents fatigue. Sorry, that says revents. Prevents fatigue, speeds recovery after surgery, considered an anti-graying vitamin. What? We can get rid of gray hair with vitamin B5? That's pretty cool.
Wait, once we
try it. I want you to start loading up with B5.
Can we alfalfa. Talk about alfalfa?
Yeah.
Because alfalfa is a common denominator of a lot of these.
Yeah.
Okay.
How can we eat alfalfa? I don't really know. Okay. I only think of alfalfa as like horses.
How do we eat alfalfa? That's such a great question. Okay, so before I started school, I never thought about alfalfa. And literally the whole 5 months I've been in school, alfalfa is like on everything we talk about, like even more than sardines. We're talking about sardines. Yeah. Alfalfa, alfalfa, alfalfa. And I'm like, what is going on with alfalfa? Like, am I supposed to be like chewing on, you know? Like, so I found this protein powder and these greens that I recommended to Dr. D. He has a big tub of it in the kitchen, and it's by a company called Purium. And Purium actually makes this tub of greens. I might actually have Mr. Witted, when he's done, go grab it. Do you mind?
Nope.
I'll show it to you guys. And like one of the top four ingredients is alfalfa. And so you just put a scoop in every morning. So that's one way I've started incorporating alfalfa. I have also seen herbal teas. So herbal tea, if you were to Google herbal tea with alfalfa, and you could get it probably with something that tastes a little better, like nettle seeds and fennel seeds and blessed thistle. And we could start becoming herbologists and start mixing it all up. But because really, you're right. Like, we don't really bake with alfalfa.
What is alfalfa?
I
don't even know what it really is.
It's like a grass.
Those little rug kids, you know, the show.
Oh, yeah. Alfalfa with a little.
Oh, yes,
with a little
hair. Spiny hair. It's all skin. I used to, when I was younger and was pregnant and doing a lot of research and stuff. My midwife recommended nettle tea.
Yes.
It has high in nutrients, minerals, good for your, good for your, for the baby, like the breast milk and stuff. It's also good for your, you know, like after giving birth, your uterus, your muscles and everything. So
yeah.
And alfalfa, but it doesn't taste good. Nettle and alfalfa do not have grassy.
Yeah.
That's
what I'm saying. So if you found an herbal tea, you
mix
could
it with
mix it with
good,
something.
Like cinnamon or
cinnamon.
Apple,
I was just
going to
say that cinnamon would be a great one.
Something good, you know.
Yeah.
Because by itself, it doesn't taste very good.
And I would say that would be the most affordable way to do it.
Yeah.
The most affordable way to get alfalfa, because it is so good for you, would be to find an herbal tea that you can stomach, or mix it with honey. Because you mix it with honey to get your B5, right? Or the B4. So find an herbal tea with alfalfa, maybe some cinnamon, maybe some nettle. Mix it with some honey to get our B4 in, and you've got like a whole mojo of goodness happening. The higher end way to do it would be to invest in something like this. And I'll pass this around to you guys, but this is Power Shake. And this was the program I was telling you about where I drank this with the amino acids. And then I had my healthy, they gave you like a list of things you could eat that were approved for this system. And it was really the whole idea of this was a reboot, you know, like to stop eating processed foods and to get back on healthy greens and things like that. I am never, ever going to recommend any diet to anybody because I don't think diets work. It's not a lifestyle. You know, you can't, so if you can't stick to it, it's not something that's realistic. You're just going to fall off track, mm-hmm. right? Anyways, I digress. Yes. So organic rice bran, organic oat flour, organic spirulina, which spirulina is really good for chlorophyll, right? Organic millet, which is a complex carbohydrate, premium gasoline, right? Organic carrot juice, organic alfalfa, organic wheat grass, organic amaranth, organic buckwheat, another piece of grass, organic quinoa, organic raspberry, organic apple, organic, and notice how every single one's organic, which is really good. Organic chia seed, which chia seeds are good for fiber. So this drink has 5 grams of fiber, 7 grams of protein. Doesn't smell that great. I like the taste of it. Personally, if you are interested in this, you can come find me and I can help you. I can help you order it. But I like it better with almond milk.
Okay, where do you put that in? Like, what do you
want? You just mix it in
make
a cup.
A shake.
Just make a shake. So you can be fancy, Marilyn. You could be real fancy and mix it with some raspberries and some strawberries and some almond milk and go brrr, blend it up. Or you can just be in a hurry, like I always am, dump it in a cup with some almond milk, give it a good shake, and run out the door.
Is that considered a meal?
Yeah, it could be a meal. I've paired it with, like, I'll have a banana with it sometimes, or I'll have a piece of toast with avocado mm-hmm. with it. It's lower calorie. So it's not, and it doesn't have, like, 20 grams of protein. It only has, like, 7.
Interesting.
So it's kind of like...
It's just like a supplement.
Yeah, it's just good for you. It's just really good for you. That's the only way I can describe it is like,
So how much is it, just for fun?
Yeah.
How much is a container like that?
Okay, so that container, no, this is a good question. That's why I said the lower cost way is herbal tea. That container is $74. And I would say if you took it every day, it wouldn't last you as long. But the first time you order it, you get $50 off. So it's $24 the first time. You could take it once a week, and it would last you a really long time.
It says 30 servings.
30 servings. Okay. Yeah. And what I do with that, to be honest with you, because it is such a high-end product,
yeah.
I just, like, when I order that, I cut out kombucha. And I just save my money by not buying kombucha, and I just take my probiotic that month. Mm-hmm. Or if I buy some of that, I just eat out less. I don't treat myself to Starbucks. Like, literally, this is what I do with myself. I'm like, okay, I spent $74 on this. It's really good for me, and I know it's got everything I need, so I'm just going to have to budget somewhere else because that's how I justify it for myself. You can't really put a price on health. But I also want to be realistic. That might not be in everybody's price range. And if it's not, I can't wait to hear about the teas you guys find that have alfalfa. Can you please email me and tell me? We're going to go into alfalfa land.
Yes. Well, also, Lori was telling me, I think you can grow your own alfalfa. I think, isn't alfalfa like a little, like, you know how like they have those, the wheat grass where they just cut them off and put them in things?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like,
okay,
that,
now we're going to have to look this up.
Yeah.
And alfalfa.
Yeah.
Alfalfa.
They add to your juice.
Yeah.
Okay, so alfalfa, also called lucerne, is a perennial flowering plant in the legume family. It's cultivated as an important forage crop in countries around the world. It's used for grazing hay and silage, as well as a green manure and cover crop. But it's really, really good for us.
Well, they use it like a green manure to replenish, I think, some of the soil that needs to be get more minerals back into the soil, just farming. So.
And then there's also the little rascals that just popped up. Alfalfa. Isn't that the best movie? I love that movie. Okay, so checking our time, we've got 30 minutes together, and I want to power through some of this. So I'm just going to power through the rest of our energy vitamins, our B6. So let's, or our B vitamins, let's jump to page 4, and it says vitamin B6. This vitamin is involved in the function of more body systems than any other vitamin, making it the most essential. The use of alcohol and tobacco impairs the absorption of B6. So if you're a smoker or you drink a lot, your B6 might be totally depleted. Good source, alfalfa. Lean organ meats, eggs, nuts, wheat germ, cantaloupe. Good for anemia, muscle spasms, and lessens PMS. B7, biotin, produced by intestinal bacteria and contributes to cell growth. B7 is good for balding. Symptoms of deficiency mimic, oh, this is a good one. Symptoms of deficiency in B7 mimic Alzheimer's. Grandma might just have a biotin deficiency. Yeah, can you believe that? Like, why, let's start with some B7, right? B7 for Alzheimer's. Go there first before we load up on all the pharma.
Yeah.
Let's give grandma some avocados, some bananas, some almonds, some brewer's yeast, eggs, especially the yolks. It's okay to eat egg yolks.
No.
It's okay to eat egg. Don't tell anyone. Okay. All right. Wheat germ, sprouts, cauliflower, mushrooms. B7. Could it mimics Alzheimer's. That's crazy. B8, one of the most abundant substances that make up our cells. Good source there. Lima beans, molasses, grapefruits, cabbage. B9 is folic acid, considered a brain food. Really important for pregnancy. Folic acid. Lily was just talking about nettle being good for pregnancy. Folic acid is very important. We can take folic acid in a supplement format or asparagus, barley, Brussels sprouts, spinach, chicken, dates. B10 reduces inflammation, also known as PABA. Bran, grains, liver, molasses, wheat germ. Isn't it amazing? It's so cool.
Can you explain what it means when it says it's folic acid is man-made?
Oh, okay. Let's go back to that one.
I don't understand.
Oh, yeah. Okay. We learned about this in school. So first things first, folic acid is man-made. So choose folate as a B9 source as often as possible. So when you buy a multivitamin, I wonder if I have one here.
Oh,
when you buy a multivitamin and it has vitamin B, which one is it? B9? And it has vitamin B9 in it, it's going to say folic acid. It was made in a lab.
No, so when we remember when we were pregnant, they were like, "Oh, you have to have folic acid; that'll help you."
Instead, you really needed folate. Wow. So I'm really glad you brought this up because I didn't know this either. So folate, from what I understand, let me back up and say that from what I was educated on in school and what I understand, folate is the actual source of vitamin B9. Mm-hmm. Folic acid is the made in a lab. Right? So when you're pregnant and they tell you you need folic acid, you need it in the form of folate. If you can. So I started looking at my vitamins too to make sure. I left them in the car, but my favorite kids vitamins are by a company called Llama, and they're chewables, and they have B9 as folate, and it's all organic fruits and veggies. So just that's kind of a fun little thing. Start looking for folate instead of folic acid. Did that answer, Allison?
Yeah.
The answer question. Okay. Do you have a question?
Well, I just wanted to go back to the whole alfalfa thing. You know,
yeah.
About how you use it. You know, you can, because I was looking up some stuff while we were talking, but just alfalfa sprouts. I mean, you can sprout your own. You can buy alfalfa seeds that are ready for sprouting, and then it says within 5-6 days they sprout.
Okay.
And you keep putting those on top of your salad or, you know, whatever. So
I love that idea.
I think that's what works for me.
Okay, so Kevin's talking about microgreens, yeah? Okay. So microgreens, I've been seeing a lot lately. If you go to Whole Foods or a health food store, They have them. You're going to notice them now. You could get them on Amazon or wherever. It's a glass jar, and it comes with microgreens. And you put the microgreens in the glass jar, and you put water in it. And it's like a five-day process. And your microgreens, like sprouts, like you put on sandwiches, start to grow. And so alfalfa is one of those microgreens you can grow. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, alfalfa sprouts. I mean, you've seen them at salad bars. They'll have a whole thing of alfalfa sprouts.
That's a really good idea. Yeah. Plus, it's cool. It's like a science experiment, right? Yeah. It's a great idea. Cool. We could do a whole lecture on alfalfa, couldn't we?
Yeah.
Okay. More energy. So notice really quick, I just want to point out, nowhere in this energy talk have we talked about like coffee. You know, like we love coffee and caffeine, and yes, it gives us energy, but it's also temporary energy, right? So the energy that we're talking about today is lasting energy. It's whole energy. It's natural energy. It's energy that's going to do more than just give us that quick burst, right? So nowhere in this energy lecture is there things like Red Bull or or Coke or coffee, even though those things, you know, we know them to give us energy. This is all natural energy. So, which actually on that note, this is another thing. Can't beat this. Beets give us natural energy. So I prefer organic raw beets cut up. Roll in olive oil, a little bit of sea salt, baked. So yummy. So yummy. Put them on your salad. But I did buy this because I just wanted to try it. And it's another one of those things you sprinkle in water. And it's got organic beetroot, organic lemon, organic coconut water. This would be a energy alternative instead of like an energy drink. And then as far as like coffee alternatives, I don't know if you guys have ever tried raw cacao. Okay, so cacao is the purest form of chocolate from a cacao pod. So if you open up these cacao pods, they're like white and milky inside. They're beautiful. Like if you go to Costa Rica and you ever see one, you'll truly appreciate cacao. But it's like a blissful energy. It's not like a rise and crash energy. Mm. So that's another good coffee alternative. Raw cacao. Cacao, yeah. And there's a local brand of cacao that I love. It's called Iekawa. 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 She's a local gal. And she sources all of her cacao from Costa Rica. So she knows the farmer, she, you know, supports the farmer, she knows the source, and then she brings it back here. And it's in the form of beans, pods, cocoa bars. You could have a cacao party. She does like cacao things where she comes to your house and you can have cacao with your friends. Mm-hmm. So anyways, that's another form of energy.
What about chicory root?
Ooh, that's something that chicory root.
As a substitute for coffee. Supposed to give you
some. Yeah, chicory root. I've heard of that.
And my brother, there's a something like a mushroom drink.
Uh-huh, mushrooms. Mud water. What is it called? Mud water.
Now I've heard of that. I don't know if that's the one that he, you know, uses, but
yeah,
as a substitute for coffee.
Yeah,
I don't remember the name of it.
So there's mushroom blends. There's one by a company called OM. OM. They make a really yummy mushroom blend. Not psychedelic mushrooms. That's another conversation in of itself, but truly mushrooms that give you energy. OM and mud water, and then chicory root, as Lily mentioned, I've seen in conjunction with dandelion root. And dandelion root is a coffee alternative, but doesn't have caffeine. So if you go from Starbucks to dandelion root, you're going to be like, Alicia is off her rocker. This does not give me energy. But over time, as you start to wean off of the pop or the coffee and replace it, and your adrenals are like, thank you, thank you, thank you. It just takes time. Mm-hmm. I love coffee. I love coffee. I love you, coffee. So I just went down to one cup a day. I try to just do one cup a day. Yeah, question.
I have an adrenals question.
Sure.
Is there a way to repair, fix, help what I've done to my adrenals?
100%.
By drinking.
Yes.
Remember what she said, that our bodies every
year
cells.
Yes. So the question was, is there a way to repair my adrenals? 150,000% yes, we can repair your adrenals. Your cells turn over every 3 months. So as you stop giving up, since you gave up pop and you don't need pop anymore and you're going to continue on that path, right? We can start to figure out, and I can help you with this too, if we need to support your adrenals, Emily, or if we need to cleanse your adrenals. There's two different ways we can go about it. Supporting your adrenals because they've been taxed for so long, or cleansing your adrenals because maybe they have a little bit more they need to let go of. There's different ways. And actually, I love this too. When we do muscle testing, which we won't get into today, but when we do muscle testing, we have someone stand like this and your kidneys and your adrenals are right here, right in your back. And we test the different sides of your adrenals to see which one's weaker and which one's stronger. And then if they want support or if they want cleansing. So, and then there's different ways we can do it. We can do it with food, which is what we're talking about tonight. We can make diet changes or we can do supplements. Like Kevin mentioned iodine. If you've been drinking fluoride water your whole life, like iodine can help with that. There are things you can take to help with your adrenals. So, yeah. So let's talk about that. So I would love to help you. All right. Let's finish the bees. Let's finish the bees and then we'll move on. There's a lot of bees. I think we left off with B11. Often works in tandem with B12 to contribute to the formation of DNA and RNA. Essential for nervous system, brain, and spinal cord. Good sources are egg yolk, organs, potatoes, green leafy veggies, such as spinach. And B12 is something you guys have all heard of, yes? Mm-hmm. First things first, take B12 with calcium so the body can better absorb this powerhouse vitamin. B12 is necessary to metabolize fats and carbs. Anemia is the most classic sign of B12 deficiency, and B12 is essential for the production of red blood cells. B12 is good for increasing energy, relieving irritability, improving concentration, and memory. Mm-hmm. Alfalfa. Clams, cod, eggs, oily fish, oysters, lamb, and tofu are good sources of B12. I also heard in school that we can better assimilate B12 when we've dealt with trauma. Remember letter D? Depression and disease, and what we store in our bodies and what we hold on to and what we harbor causes illness. We're not going to be able to assimilate our energy, and we're not going to be able to assimilate our B12 if we don't deal with our traumas. We've all had traumas, right? It's never too late to find help for those things. I can be a resource to you. And yeah, so it can help you better assimilate. This is going to blow your mind. I know all of this is just blowing your mind. B17, see handout. I couldn't believe this. Okay, so this is not in your stapled stuff. B17, it says illegal in the U.S. at the top. So maybe I should stop the video. Do you guys see it? It's not stapled. It's in the very back.
Got stars written on.
Stars. Illegal in the U.S. You guys aren't privy to the top secret information. There's going to be helicopters flying overhead. B17, illegal in the U.S., cancer prevention. Does everyone have this?
Yes.
You see it? Oh, maybe. In the packet?
Yeah.
That's okay. I want to make sure you found it.
Yes.
This is really cool. I told you guys this is going to be nutrition like you've never had nutrition before. So the Navajo and Hopi Indians, the Hunza people, Eskimos, and other cultures know the truth and benefit of the apricot kernel. which holds the richest source of B17. To date, there have been no known cancers found within these tribes. A relatively simple compound found in our food supply, it is primarily found in seeds or non-citrus fruits. Nitrilocide is a generic term for beta-cyanoformic glycosylphosphate. Oh, thank you for that. A large group of water-soluble sugary compounds. The most common nitrilocide is amygdalin. I'm not going to say all this right. Beta-glucosidide, one of the several enzymes that catalyze the release of cyanide from amygdalin, is present in the small intestine in many common foods. Okay, that was way too much information. Basically, what you need to know is that apricot kernels hold the richest form of B17. Rule of thumb, eat the fruit along with the seeds. How cool is that? Benefits, effective means to control cancer, help pain associated with arthritis, and help lower blood pressure. Alfalfa sprouts, apple seeds, apricot kernels, bamboo shoots, beet tops. Eat the whole beet, right? Throw it in your smoothie. Barley, blackberries, boysenberries, blah, 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 gooseberries. There's a whole list, but
eucalyptus,
mung beans. I mean, don't you guys just want to run out and buy all of these foods right now?
Okay, but what are apricot? You're talking the pit or something else?
That's a great question. What is an apricot kernel?
Isn't it?
It's got to be
the seed.
Yeah, it's not the hard shell. Yeah, it's the seed inside. But I've heard it has arsenic in it. And if you eat too much of it.
Oh, is that what it was saying about
that's
arsenic?
Apple seeds.
Yeah.
But you have to eat, I think you have to eat a lot of them to get
arsenic
poisoning.
Oh, organic apricot seeds. They sell them. An apricot kernel is the apricot seed located within the fruit endocarp, which forms a hard shell around the seed called the pyrena. The kernel contains amygdalin, a poisonous compound in concentrations that vary between cultivars. Okay, so that's probably why it's illegal in the U.S.
Yeah.
is if you eat it in large portions.
Yeah.
But you can still buy your apricots and then do it.
Okay, so what our takeaway from this is we just eat the whole apricot, right? Mm-hmm. Or if we get apricot kernels, we don't eat the whole bag of them.
Okay, can I just say, I tend to be a little bit of a conspiracy theorist.
Okay,
and
tell us, girl.
You know, like it's saying, so right away, on this article, it says that a man poisoned himself. There is sketchy, it says debates have long raged among medical professionals and patients about the effectiveness of vitamins and natural supplements. There is sketchy evidence at best for many of these natural cures, and some are downright dangerous. Mm-hmm. So it's saying that an otherwise healthy man poisoned himself by eating apricot kernels. So,
It says it contains a plant toxin, amygdalin, which converts to cyanide after eating.
Right.
Do some research.
Right.
Be smart
right.
about it.
Be smart about it.
I think most people have heard that apple seeds have cyanide. You know, there's probably the amygdalin in them. And if you eat too many of those, that can be dangerous. You just have to.
And the entire dental industry puts amalgams in our teeth, which contain mercury, which poison the shit. Sorry, pardon my French.
You're on tape.
I know. They poison the crap out of our bodies. I'm sorry. That's
like
how angry.
Yeah.
That is how angry I am about that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's what we did, too. We got
bleep, bleep, bleep.
We got our fillings out.
You can get apricot kernel oil.
Yeah.
Wait, they put it in the fillings?
Amalgam fillings have mercury, and they leak mercury into your mouth.
When they say it's a silver amalgam, and they say that amalgam contains toxic metals.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
So point being, the reason that I brought that up is, if you Google something, they're going to tell you 100 ways it's wrong for you, or 100 ways it's good for you. So you really just have to do your own research. But yes, do you have any amalgam fillings?
I have some fillings that I got when I was a kid.
Me too.
Same. Probably have a melon.
Well, are they silver?
They're silver color.
Then yes, then you have a melon.
Yeah, I do too. And my goal and objective is to get them out of my mouth as quickly as possible.
And
but
we
have to do it from a biological dentist.
20 years ago, that's exactly what they put in. Nobody knew any better.
Yeah.
So you got it, whether you knew it or not.
Right.
That's why you have it.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, and I want to bring up an important point. This is going all the way back to A, but allopathic medicine is different from naturopathic medicine. Both treat the body. However, allopathy treats the symptom and targets the specific organ or part that is affected. There's always a risk of side effects. Natural medicine looks at the root of the problem and aims to cure the whole body and not just the affected part. So treatments for natural medicine often include plant-based remedies, non-invasive, non-harmful preventative measures. So when we talk about something like apricot seeds, or anything we're talking about today, alfalfa or all these natural remedies, allopathic medicine or Western medicine, that's not what they do. Their side of medicine is treating the symptom and treating the organ or treating that part of your body. So what we're talking about today is healing the body from a holistic perspective. Right. So when we say apricot seeds might have cyanide or they might be bad for us, we just have to be smart about anything we put in our bodies that's, you know, at any point, at any time, including Tylenol.
Yeah, too much of anything.
Right. Too much of anything. Mm-hmm. Right, right. Right. So all of it. But sorry, I got a little heated there for a second.
A good thing to end on is it says the man at the center of this case was allowed to leave the hospital, but despite all of the evidence presented to him, he has decided to continue on self-treating with apricot kernels.
Right. I love it. I love it.
He's probably just decided he'll do less.
Yeah.
Well, you know,
probably. Yeah. There's an app called Brave. Have you guys heard of Brave? Mm-hmm. So Brave is Google without censoring. And I'm on camera, but whatever.
It's Google?
It's so if you look up the app Brave and you start searching using the app Brave instead of Google, it'll give you articles that Google sent, like normal search engine sensor. So it's called Brave. You can just look up more stuff. I don't want to forget to the psyllium husk.
Yes,
what was that? Okay, so we did not even get to the herbs section. I am actually hosting an entire hour specifically on herbs, and we're going to do an herb exchange at one of my friend's houses. So if you guys would like to come to that, you're more than welcome. You're all invited. And that one will be specifically on H, which is herbs, and we'll talk all about herbology. There's actually a woman that's going to be there that she's a local herbologist too. So she's quite an expert in this area. So I can email you the date if you guys want to come to that. But for today's purposes, we were just talking about natural remedies, and I had you guys dump in this jar raw psyllium husk. So it's around somewhere.
Yeah.
Jar of it. I brought it over here. Okay, so this is psyllium seed husk. So psyllium is an herb. Psyllium is a plant. And, like, you can grow it in your garden if you want to. And then I wanted to show this to you guys because it becomes this gel-like. It's almost like a, if you were to take a drink of this, it would feel like you're drinking aloe vera a little bit. It's a mucilaginous herb. Mucilaginous, right? Like aloe vera or mucus. Yeah, like a kind of goopy, whatever. But this is what it does in your body. So it's that, like that thicker, gloopy, gooiness that pushes, it's like that fiber that pushes everything out of your small intestine and your large intestine. So eventually you can eliminate it, right? So I wanted to show this to you guys because psyllium husk is an all natural way to do that. If you go to the store and you get Mucilix or Benefiber or any kind of unnatural fiber, you don't need to. Like, you can literally just grab these psyllium husk capsules, or you could get psyllium husk powder and dump it in your water. And it's an all natural way to flush things through your system.
Hmm.
Aloe vera will do the same thing. If you guys drink aloe vera water, or Kevin was talking about coconut oil also being another great way if you have poop issues that you can flush things through. But if you were to do a side-by-side experiment of Metamucil and psyllium husk, you would see that it's the same exact thing, except Metamucil has been dyed with red number 40 and is loaded. It's just loaded with all sorts of crap, you know.
What about Benefiber? Because I know that one is no color, no nothing.
Yeah, read the label. Read the label just to make sure, because if Benefiber is just psyllium husk and, you know, it's just read the label. You'll know. So I know that I'm trying to see. Okay, we're right at 6 o'clock. Gosh, there's so much more I want to cover. What was the question?
Just a quick one. Is psyllium husk something you can take every day to make sure that stuff is or like
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Psyllium husk would be safe enough to take every day because it's literally just a plant.
It's not gonna make you have the opposite problem.
I would say though, you probably don't need to take it every day. I mean, unless you're not going to the bathroom every day, you might just need to up your apples and your carrots and your berries. And one of the things in the packet, which for homework, I hope you guys will go home and read all the information that's in here, but it talks about the ideal eating scenario to be, I think it's 45% raw. No, 45%. Let me find it. Because this will also help with that. There we go. It's page 11, ideal diet. There is no one size fits all when it comes to diet. Dr. Ted Mortar, author of a book called Your Health, Your Choice, believes that we are eating too much protein, which is harder for our bodies to digest and break down. Based on his research, he found that high protein intake continually dumps toxins into our system. His recommended ideal diet is 45% cooked vegetables and fruits, 30% raw veggies and fruits, and 25% other. But remember, the rule of thumb, there is no one right diet for everyone. We have to take into account our blood type, nervous system, allergies, past experiences, muscle testing, and so many other factors. Your body is a very special, unique entity that deserves top-notch fuel for optimal health. So eating, the reason that I brought that up is eating more veggies and fruits will help you be more regular. But if there were days you needed to take psyllium husk or maybe make some chia seed pudding, so chia seeds with coconut milk and sweetened with all natural honey. So really yummy, like all natural. Actually, I'm going to make some. I'll make some and bring it in so you guys can try it. And you use cacao. You put some raw cacao in there. You're invited. Sounds You'll have good. To come back for dessert. the only other thing, I know we're out of time, but I absolutely have to point this out to you guys. And then I'll take a couple questions. We did start about 50 minutes late too.
Yeah,
so, but I do want to be sensitive to your time. I have to point out to you guys, real food versus fake food. We didn't even get there. I have to point out to you guys, there is a handout in the very back, I believe. Magnesium, sugar. Yeah. Okay. So at the top, it says how to test pH. Do you guys see that?
Yes.
All right, so everybody take that out, how to test pH. We are not going over how to test pH today, but you guys can always reach out to me with questions. Where I want you to turn is the very back of that section where it says alkaline ash foods. This is super important. And if there's one thing I end with today, I want it to be this. Does everybody see alkaline ash foods? I think it's in the very back.
Sorry, I'm not.
It says you're fine. All right. So flip, I think keep flipping.
Yes.
Okay. So this is something that we should be teaching in nutrition and dietetics. This is something that we should be teaching our kids. This is something that I wish I knew a long time ago. So we have something in our body called an alkaline reserve. Okay. And the alkaline reserve is our mineral reserve. It's what gives our bodies all the minerals that our body needs, okay? The minerals, the alkaline reserve is depleted with acid foods. Okay? So picture a piggy bank in your body. Okay? We want to keep putting money into the piggy bank, into this alkaline reserve. But we keep putting in coffee and pop and hamburgers and french fries, and we keep depleting the piggy bank. What's going to happen? All of our minerals are going to run out. It's going to start depleting our vitamins. It's going to start pulling from our bones and cause osteoporosis. It's going to start causing all sorts of things to happen to our body. So how do we increase the alkaline reserve in our bodies? Well, these foods leave something behind in our bodies called an alkaline ash. So just like when you make a fire in a fireplace and you get all that ash, this happens in our bodies, you guys. This happens. It happens with acids and it happens with alkaline. So alkaline ash foods, eat these foods to increase your alkaline reserve. Have you guys all seen the alkaline water?
Mm-hmm.
In plastic bottles, of course. Why don't they put it in glass? More expensive, that's why. The alkaline water is trying to rebalance your pH to be more alkaline because cancer and disease cannot live in an. Where do cancer and disease live? Acid, acid environment. So when we do your test, when we get together later, because you guys are going to come back and we're going to do so many cool things together. If we ever test your pH, your urine or your saliva, it would tell us where you are on the pH scale.
Hmm.
Kevin did this with me already. Thank you.
Yeah.
He was good. He was good. I'm not going to tell you his number. That would be like it's HIPAA or something.
Patient,
it's private. private confidentiality. Yes. You should know for sure. But anyways, so these are alkaline ash foods. Then the acid ash foods are the other page. You can see you also have your acid ash food. So let's say you eat bacon. Acid ash food, bacon. Okay, well, if you're going to eat bacon, then have an apple. If you're going to eat barley, have a banana. You see? You see? Yeah. Because you all have a piggy bank. Your alkaline reserve, you don't want to deplete it, right?
Okay, so wait, are you saying we should have a balance between these?
Well, if you could eat all alkaline, that would be amazing.
Yeah.
But real life happens, right?
Yeah.
You're going to eat bacon and peanut butter and yogurt and
sardines.
And the honey.
Oh, salmon and sardines are on here. So do you know why that is? You know why? Here's why. And this is only because we don't have a lot of time to talk about it. They're a protein. And protein is harder for the body to digest. So when the body is working to digest the protein, the salmon and the sardines and the things that are good for us, it's producing acid. So when the body is working to digest, it's producing acid. Right? So it doesn't mean it's bad for us. Let me clarify that. Acid ash foods doesn't necessarily mean the food is bad for us. It means it's producing acid. So we have to take alkaline to put out the fire, right? So if you look on the alkaline ash list, there's no protein. Well, lima beans, I guess, but maybe those are easier to digest by the body. Pineapple, pears, green beans, lemons, beets, broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cabbage, which actually we think of lemons, this is interesting because we think of lemons as being acidic, but they're metabolized by the body as alkaline.
Interesting.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
And so when things are out of balance, that's when we have disease, right? Yeah, question.
Kale. Is kale acidic or alkaline? I was just curious because it's something that we eat.
Kale. I know, I don't see it.
You see it. Collards, which is
I would think kale would be alkaline.
Okay.
And actually, there's a K for kale. I knew you loved kale, so I gave you a whole alphabet for it. Let's see, K for kale. What does it say about our love, love, love friend kale? I love kale. H-I-J-K, kale and other leafy greens, so good for you. Grow your own, eat it daily, buy organic, weight loss, antioxidant rich, keeps skin healthy and strong, anti-inflammatory, detoxes, boosts metabolism, high in protein. Oh, so it might be an acid. We'll have to look it up. Protects against macular degeneration. That's cool. Immune boosting, packed with phytonutrients, high in fiber. So many cool things about kale. Mm-hmm. Let's look it up really quick because I want you to leave here with the answer. Is kale alkaline ash or acid ash? Okay, so dark leafy greens such as kale, spinach, beet greens, savoy cabbage, Swiss chard have an alkaline rating of 8.0 and above. There you go.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So I told you guys that was a lot of information, and my hope and prayer is that I did not overwhelm you to the point where you can't walk away with some little tidbits. So what stuck with you tonight?
I need some bees.
Alfalfa.
Alfalfa. You need some bees?
I love that. You should get some bees.
Some bees. No, not beets. Bees. Like
bees.
Like, well,
yeah. Propolis. Okay. Propolis and bee pollen. Mm-hmm. I think you should get some bees.
Ooh, I think she's getting
like
bees.
Vitamin
bees. All
those oh,
bees.
I thought you were going to buy bees.
Honeybees.
Honeybees. She's talking about all the bees. You need no, bee vitamins. Amen, sister.
Like
bee vitamins. Yes. Yes, you can definitely, you need to get some bees for sure. What else? Does anyone have any other questions?
I know you can leave us a sheet where it gives you the blood type.
Yeah.
And you explained a little bit about that. So are you going to talk about
We
that?
Can talk about it if you guys want to spend the time doing it real quick. You want to talk about blood type real quick?
Yes, please.
Okay. If anybody needs to leave, can you guys just do me a favor and make sure you signed in?
There's
a sign-in sheet, and I really appreciate it. So the purpose of the sign-in sheet is so that I can turn it into school to let them know you were here. And then also, if you guys give me permission, I will email you for future upcoming workshops. Okay?
Yeah.
Who knows their blood type?
I don't know.
All right, shout out. What's your blood type?
O.
You're an O. Okay. So the first one on the list, blood type O. Over 40% of the population is blood type O. You guys are the hunters and gatherers. Grass-fed red meat is okay 3 to 4 times a week. You benefit from meat, seafood, veggies, limited grains, beans and legumes. Avoid corn. Mm-hmm. The biggest thing there is if it's non-GMO corn and you're like growing your own, you can have it once in a while. But avoid corn, wheat, and processed dairy. Your body just doesn't do well with it because of your blood type. Do you notice that?
I noticed that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Strong, practical, workaholic. Does that ring a bell?
Yeah. I'm her friend. I can
Okay.
I
with the schooler,
she splits wood.
She splits wood. That makes perfect sense. Must work out, stays physically active. Stress can manifest itself in an overactive fight or flight response. Prone to gut issues, low thyroid production, and arthritis.
Yeah,
there you go. So you learned today how to handle those things, right? Now, we didn't talk about gut issues, but every single one of you needs to be on a probiotic. Please, please. You have to be on a probiotic for your gut health, okay? Yes.
Which I just read that that would be like kombucha, sour, what is that stuff?
Yep.
The stuff that sits
in the counter.
Kimchi.
Kimchi, sauerkraut. Kombucha, kefir, probiotics, anything fermented builds the microbiome in your gut. My research paper for school is actually going to be on gut health, brain health. Like, it's that important.
You need fermented because alcohol is fermented.
That's true. Alcohol is fermented.
Okay, but
yeah.
Can we do a class some night on learning to make your own kimchi? Because I would really like to learn how to make my own kimchi.
Okay, let's do it. Could we use the kitchen downstairs?
Yes.
Sure, we
make
can.
Your own kimchi.
I'm so excited.
That would be amazing. We could also do the Sunshine House. Do it in the kitchen here or the Sunshine House. All right, is anybody an A? Type A blood?
I think I'm
A. I'm an A.
Check my grades.
Also, if you don't know your blood type and you want me to take your blood and get a blood type, you can let me know after
Miracles
class.
Take a lot.
Another thing Kevin let me do, he's so good. You just prick your finger and we put it on a tester and it'll tell. Yeah, we'll tell what kind of blood you are. So type A's are 40% of the population. Okay, so type O's were over 40%. Type A are 40%. Farmers, gardeners benefit from veggies, fruit, tofu, seafood, grains, and legumes the most. Can tolerate some turkey or chicken. Avoid red meat. Avoid tomatoes. Avoid white potatoes and processed dairy. This is just going to make your body happy. Organized and goal-oriented. I can attest to that. Stress and excess of cortisol. Where do we store cortisol?
Yeah.
Belly fat, right? So how do we reduce cortisol?
Decrease stress.
Decrease stress. One yoga class decreases your stress by 20%, your cortisol. 20%.
If only there was somebody who knew.
If only there was someone who taught yoga. So benefit from yoga, breathing, meditation. We're prone to heart disease, diabetes, cancer, liver, and gallbladder disorders. So we're going to take B vitamins and alfalfa, and we're going to do all the things. Any type Bs? Okay. Type Bs are 10% of the population. They're the nomads. They're a more balanced omnivore. They should eat lamb. Do you have any bees in your life? Yeah. Seafood, eggs, veggies, fruit, rosemary, garlic yogurt. Oh, garlic. Not garlic yogurt. Don't eat garlic. Well, I guess that would be like Middle Eastern, right? Avoid corn, wheat, tomatoes, no peanuts, no chicken, no shrimp. Promotes weight gain. They're the intellectual. Always want to know how and why. No treadmill. Exercise must use strategy or have a mental component. Golf. Golf would be a great thing for type B bloods. Stress causes nervous system issues, prone to autoimmune diseases and diabetes. If you're a type AB, you are the lowest percent of the population. You don't find as many ABs. They're the farmers, the nomads, intermingling development, highly tolerant immune systems. They benefit from turkey. They should avoid corn, chicken, shrimp. They cannot tolerate tomatoes. They love to learn. They're spiritual. They're sensitive. Calming, centering exercises combined with moderate exercise, and they're prone to heart disease and cancer. So there are books upon books, you guys, on eating for your blood type. However, in a world that confuses us with this diet and that diet, and I should eat this and I shouldn't eat this, always go back to what feels right for your body. If you're a blood type O and it says, I should not eat, no, if you're a blood type A and it says, I should not eat red meat, but you sit down and you have a piece of steak and a potato and whatever, it's okay. You know what I mean? Like, just the next day, go back to your greens and your salad and your tofu. And we have to live life, right? We have to be smart about these things. So, whoo, yeah. What else? Anything else before we get out of here? So your packet of information did not go through a cholesterol handout, so read that on your own. We did not go through gut health. I have an entire hour lecture on the YouTube channel on gut health. It's a Zoom. We did a Zoom if you want to see that. We talked about hydration. We talked about the ideal diet. We didn't go over juicing, but juicing is pretty straightforward, and we did talk about the benefits of juicing. L is for love yourself, super important. Self-love, love yourselves. Our cells remember everything we tell them. You guys have heard about the power of what we tell ourselves. It's very true. There's a whole handout on it. We didn't go over minerals. On my Instagram channel, I covered one mineral every day for a week. It was fun. Like, phosphorus is the light mineral. Magnesium is super good for relaxation, very important mineral. Nervous system, again, we are what we eat. Oils, there's a whole handout on healthy oils and the different kinds of oils.
Like essential oils or like?
No, not essential oils. Food oils. Okay. Yep, there's a whole handout in there for you. plants and herbs. We did the psyllium test. If you want to come to my herb chat, I'm doing a whole, it'll probably be another 2 hours with a bunch of women. And there might be some men there, actually. I don't want to say there won't be men there, but it's an herb exchange, and I can give you the date. Are real food versus fake food? Eat a green apple, not a green gummy bear. There you go. End of discussion. Okay? Eat non-GMO corn on the cob, not ultra-processed Doritos. Sugar. Oh, man. That's a whole nother night. But there is a handout on sugar. Sugar's bad for you. There we go. End of discussion.
What do you think is the best alternative?
To sugar?
Yeah. The actual sugar?
Well, fruit. Yeah. Fruit.
Like, what do you use? Monk
fruit? Uh-huh. Monk fruit. Monk fruit and honey. Monk fruit. It's a fruit that they have turned into, they've pared it down to sugar base. You can cook with it.
About agave?
Agave is great. Agave is great.
I've heard a little bit of controversy whether it's as good as they say it is versus.
Really?
Just a little bit.
Okay.
Barely. I didn't know if you knew anything about that or not, but. I heard it's not as good as they claim it is, and that.
I haven't heard any controversy over agave, but that's good to know because we're all here to learn from each other. Yeah. So I'll have to look into that.
Yeah.
What about stevia?
My question there is stevia. Let me see if our sugar handout tells us. I think stevia is okay, to be honest with you.
Stevia is a plant-based.
Stevia is a plant-based. Yeah. I'm pretty sure that one's okay.
Fruit sounds like a fruit-based.
And too much white sugar depletes your B vitamins. We don't want that. Depletes your minerals. Here we go. Oh, no, that's not it. Breast milk, a good source of. Well, we won't be getting any of that. I'm pretty sure stevia is okay because it's from a plant. Monk fruit's a great one. Honey. I mean, if you have like maple syrup straight from the tree, that'd be great, right? So much better than white processed, bleached sugar.
Be careful with honey or maple syrup in terms of the glucose index. If you're a diabetic,
you do.
Be careful, but it is better than processed white sugar.
Yes.
Okay, real quickly, tell us why the extra virgin olive oil cannot be heated.
What? Oh, are you looking at the oil sheet?
Yeah.
What? Okay, let me go back to my memory bank. Extra virgin olive oil cannot be heated to a certain point because it turns rancid.
Yeah.
So extra virgin olive oil should not be your oil of choice for pan frying.
Yeah, it should be your oil of choice for pan frying.
Yeah. Avocado.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Oh, avocado oil?
Avocado oil. It has a higher heating point. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know, right?
Yeah.
Pretty cool. And coconut oil too, but coconut oil is that at room temperature it hardens. You just have to stick some in and let it melt.
Cook with.
I love making pancakes with coconut oil.
I never thought of that. I have some coconut oil in my cupboard because I tried to do this diet once that I couldn't stick to. And so I still have jars of coconut oil.
Allison uses coconut oil
I could use it to cook.
And it's anti-parasitic.
She does it for pies for all of her crust, she uses coconut oil, and then she also uses that when she makes that breakfast thing for the staff with
waffles,
honey,
the granola and the honey,
natural peanut butter, coconut
oil, so good,
granola, and then she bakes it with fruit on top.
So, and I think people look at coconut oil and say, "Oh, that's high in saturated fat. I shouldn't eat that." But you have to look at the other benefits of it. There's so many benefits to coconut oil. You know, we've gotten so far removed from, "I can't eat that because it's too much fat," or like avocados.
It's a different kind of fat.
It's a different kind of fat. It's a fat we need, and it's a fat for our brains. It's a
actually helps your bad cholesterol.
And it helps your bad cholesterol. It coats your nerves. People with MS where the myelin sheath around their nerves has all unwinded. We need those good fats. Mm-hmm. So I think moral of the story is we need to go back to what God created, right? We need to go back to the foods that God intended for us to eat that are not processed, that are grown from the earth. And unfortunately, nowadays, we have to make sure they're not sprayed with nasty.
My trouble is this, because every time, like, we just purchased something that we needed to get, and sure enough, your regular whatever leaf we needed, 200 leaves, $8.99. You click on the organic, it was $17.99.
Yeah. It's highway robbery.
Right.
It's so backwards that in order to eat organic and healthy, we have to break the bank. That is also why.
I thought it would have been easy to just take it off the tree, put it in the bag, and send it to me at least.
Yes.
A friend of mine who's a nutritionist that I've seen, have gone to in the past. Said that it's not as, I mean, organic is great. She said it's wonderful if you can afford it. But, she said you also have to be careful. She said make sure the label says non-GMO. Because a lot of times nowadays, the way that they label organic, it's not always non-GMO. So if you can buy something, if you're buying something, just make sure it's non-GMO label is on it. And it doesn't have to be organic.
So what, Leah, I'm going to give this bag to you so you can see it. It says glyphosate free, right here, glyphosate free, bio-checked, non-glyphosate certified, non-GMO, USDA organic. So like this bad boy hit on all the things. Sprouted organic gluten-free rolled oats. Like this is good stuff right here. So another thing to look for. And then what is going around and being passed out is if you can only afford, if your budget can only afford, thankfully. Okay, so every year this company puts out something called, every year this company puts out something called the Clean 15 and the Dirty 12. So the Clean 15 are, it's okay to buy non-organic if you had to choose.
Oh, yeah, because there's a skin around it. Like,
and the Dirty 12, absolutely do not get anything but organic this year.
Now I understand. I thought we were, I was like, how could these be bad for?
So the Dirty 12 are dirty, meaning that they're heavily sprayed. The strawberries, spinach, kale, nectarines, apples, grapes, buy all organic. The Clean 15 are, you know what? This is going to break the bank this month. I can't really afford to get my avocados and my pineapple organic. Well, it's okay. It's okay. This year. So next year, they'll come out with a new list. And then you can always soak your fruits and veggies in apple cider vinegar in the sink.
Oh, I never heard of that. And I heard that's kind of so much cheaper than that spray stuff.
You can buy the spray.
Wash.
What's it?
The veggie wash, yeah.
You can buy the veggie wash. You can buy the veggie wash or fill a sink with warm water. Maybe do a little bit of sea salt and some apple cider vinegar and let your fruit and veggies soak and then eat it. And then you also get the benefits of apple cider vinegar.
Yeah, how much apple cider vinegar would you say?
Per gallon?
Yeah.
Just a couple tablespoons. Yeah.
And you said, okay, apple cider vinegar and what?
Salt? A little sea salt.
Sea salt.
A little sea salt. Yeah. And then that'll clean your fruits and veggies.
That's good to know.
Yeah. Plus apple cider vinegar has got a whole host of benefits to it also, right?
No, it's okay.
Yeah.
We could add a whole other night.
I know. In all seriousness, though, you guys, I am so grateful that you guys came and were a part of this. And I really, really hope you learned something new, a takeaway. So thank you for letting me have this here, being a place to host it. Bye to you online. Thank you for being a part of this.
Yay
to you.